you here. It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Royal Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. My question, Minister of Finance. Minister, you know, sadly, something historic happened today. We heard from the OPP Commissioner regarding the criminal investigation of the OPP into the Premier's office and the Liberal Party. And the unfortunate consequence of the fact that you're being criminally investigated not once but twice means that you're spending a lot of resources, quite frankly, protecting the Liberal Party instead of creating jobs for people in the province of Ontario. Basically, because of these scandals involving criminal activity, you don't have the focus on getting our economy moving again and creating jobs. You're spending time covering Liberal hides than creating jobs for our province. So given you're so consumed by the OPP investigations, I've got a jobs plan to put people back to work. Will you support my million jobs plan debated in the Legislative Assembly later this afternoon?
Minister of Finance.
Can you see it, please? And while the clock is stopped, I'm going to remind all members, I do not want to hear individual names. We know that that's not appropriate. The convention here is that you either say their title or their riding, and I'll stick tight to that. And that includes the sidebars. Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. You know, on this side of the House, we're able to manage many files concurrently. And we're able to stimulate the economy and grow our economy and create those jobs. And we put up with some of the nonsense that comes from that side of the House in regards to some of the investigations that they purport to tell. The OPP Commissioner told us today, and this is what, and I quote, "I am told by our investigators that the OPP is receiving good cooperation from senior government officials in this matter. They have our full cooperation." They further say that the Premier has been very accepted, very responsible. We've taken a stand. She's actually called for the investigations, and we're moving forward. But, Mr. Speaker, I recall, as someone who was involved with protecting the communities, the member opposite stood in that community, promised to cancel that power plant without consequences any further. Mr. Speaker, they just do the same.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Let me be clear. It's the OPP stormed into the Premier's office, not anybody else's. let's be clear about that. So the Minister of Finance assured that they can handle both, that they can spend half their time on OPP criminal investigations and then half their time on the economy. Minister, I just wish you'd made the right decisions so you could focus 100% of your time on creating jobs in our province. Look, you yourself were involved in these decisions. Your finance minister, you asked for billions of dollars to be spent to save Liberal seats, including your own. You supported the Green Energy Act that has now seen hydro rates more than double in the province of Ontario. Part of my million jobs plan is to end the unaffordable subsidies to wind and solar. It's causing job losses. For every short-term job we create putting up a wind turbine, we lose four in the broader economy. So let me ask you directly. You're the Minister of Finance. Before you signed on to these unaffordable wind and solar subsidies, did you look at how many jobs it would cost?
Thank you. Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So the member opposite has what we refer to as Killing Million Jobs Act. This is about a job loss plan. This is his plan, Mr. Speaker. Very thin on specifics.
Order.
We have a plan that has created jobs, over 600,000 jobs, Manager.
I did not get things quiet for the member from Renfrew to get his heckle in. Thank you. The member from Barrie will come to order. Finish.
Mr. Speaker, the member opposite's plan for right to work is about killing jobs. It's about killing prominent jobs in our community, and it's not forward-thinking. He's going backwards in time,
Thank
Mr.
You.
Speaker, and you can't compete in that regard.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
You know, with that kind of sophomoric response, no wonder we can't attract jobs to the province. I expect better from the finance minister of the province. So, let me ask you, part of leadership is imagining the future you want for the next generation, one full of jobs, good-paying jobs, and then you build the steps to get there. I've done that plan, and I'm ready to lead us there, to get taxes down, to get energy rates under control, to make sure we make the decisions necessary to balance our books, including the cross-board wage freeze that you used to support, but you
Mr. Training College University
cast aside
come to order.
Deep in debt. You hear the same thing I do. I know you do. Every business owner I talk to, large or small, is concerned about skyrocketing hydro rates. You know that your subsidies to wind and solar have been an economic failure. My question for you is, why are you going to dig the hole deeper? Why not
question?
Increase my plan for affordable energy so we can create jobs again?
Exactly. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister of Finance.
So, Mr. Speaker, we talk about sophomoric and simplistic plans brought forward by this man and this party. We are the leanest government in Canada, Mr. Speaker. The steps that we have taken, we are the lowest per capita government anywhere in Canada. 4 years running, we have controlled our spending, we've been very disciplined, and we're the only government to have actually cut spending year over year. And we're taking steps necessary to meet our targets and balance our books by 2017-18. But this is what they say about Mr. Hudak's...
I heard very little talking while the question was being put. I'm hearing too much talking while the answer is being put. Stop it. Finish, please.
This is what they say about this risky and radical plan that goes back in time. And I quote, Ontario PC leader Tim Hudak's latest economic offering is simplistic, headline-hunting plan that's more concerned with austerity than job creation, and it ignores many of the most important drivers.
Member from McKeon College and come to order. Answer.
He often quotes Don Drummond, and this is what he has to say. It's extremely unlikely to produce many jobs. A few calculations should have been
Thank
made
you.
That evident, said Don Drummond.
Thank you. Your question, the Leader of Opposition.
Well, thank you. Back to the Finance Minister. I just am somewhat incredulous that the Finance Minister would describe his government as a lean government. I mean, how in the world can you say a government with the biggest deficit in Canada and the most indebted jurisdiction of states and provinces in North America is lean?
They're referring to their plan.
I think we need a new Finance Minister. I think we need a new government. I think we've got to get on that track. The minister obviously wants to continue to embrace the Dalton McGuinty approach of expensive energy, so let me try a different tack that's part of my jobs plan. At least Dalton McGuinty and Dwight Duncan finally came around to an across-the-board wage freeze, legislated if necessary.
Question.
That was my plan. It's part of my million jobs plan. So to help us get out of the deep debt, will you support my bill, which will bring an across-the-board wage freeze to make sure we have less debt
Thank
and
you.
Attract investment to our province?
Thank you.
So, Mr. Speaker, we are the lowest-cost government in Canada. We have, because of the controls and the measures we've taken necessary steps to control our spending, but we've been very strategic, Mr. Speaker, in stimulating economic growth. That's why we've created over 164% more jobs in this province, in this jurisdiction, compared to anywhere else. Compared to the United States, that's only at 80%. So we're taking those steps. And, Mr. Speaker, the man opposite is proposing a bill that's going to create cuts in our economy, especially now that we have a sensitive recovery. His plan is going to reduce nurses, reduce doctors, cut teachers, eliminate very valuable jobs in our community. And we're still, Mr. Speaker, we are the top destination for foreign direct investment. They will be cautioned because of the work that this man is proposing.
Supplementary.
You know, Minister, respectfully, the first path to recovery in Ontario is admitting that you've got a problem.
Yep.
You put us deep in debt. You've increased taxes. You've increased energy rates almost twofold. I've seen the commercials by the RNAO. You're actually the party that's laying off nurses in the province of Ontario. So let's get our facts straight on this. So you're not going to rein in spending. You're not going to stop the energy increase. So let me ask you this. The man who seems to call the shots is not you, but it's Pat Dillon of the Working Families Coalition. They brought in a new bureaucracy called the College of Trades, and now you want to have compulsory certification for carpenters or reduce jobs there. Look, my plan is to create 250,000 jobs in the skilled trades, to take aside this bureaucracy that stands in the way, to move to a one-to-one journeyman to apprentice ratio. I want a bright future for people in middle-class jobs in the trades. Will you support that, or are you stuck in the past and deep in Pat Dillon's pocket?
You see it, please. Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, the opposition is putting their heads in the sand. They are stuck in the past. They want to go back to the glory days of smokestacks burnt on coal and compete with assembly line. That is not where we're going to be competitive in the future. We know that we have new manufacturing. We've got more sectors created in Ontario than any other province combined. We got more startups in this province because of the initiatives that we've taken. And Mr. Speaker, the man opposite is suggesting that we provide work to rule, right to work legislation that would cut those jobs. He wants to lower wages as opposed to provide those value added. We're investing in people. We're investing in education. We're providing youth programs so that we get more young people employed so that they have the skills necessary to compete in the new economy of the future, of tomorrow. He still wants to go back to yesterday, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
I understand you are a significant player in the Dalton McGuinty government. You are convinced that you want to continue down that path. You're stuck in the past. I've got a bold, fresh plan to put people back to work in good middle-class jobs in our province. I call it the Million Jobs Plan. It's debated this afternoon. And here's the difference, Minister. You choose expensive wind and solar subsidies. I choose affordable energy so we can hire again. You chose 300,000 more government jobs. I choose 1 million good jobs in the private sector to put people back to work in our province. You choose higher taxes. I choose lower taxes so we'll invest in Ontario and create jobs again. You chose to double the debt. I'm calling for the debt to come down to say Ontario is open for business again. You're choosing Dalton McGuinty. I'm choosing the people, the province of Ontario, who want hope, who want to get back working on great province. Why don't you?
Be seated, please.
Thank you. Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, we have to collaborate with all levels of government for the benefit of the people of Ontario. The individual across the way is suggesting that we do across-the-board cuts and not stimulate economic growth. There's time for restraint. There is time for us to control our spending. And we've already employed many measures of austerity for the benefit of providing valuable services at lower costs. That's why we are the lowest per capita cost government in the country. But this member now opposite is now suggesting that what we need to do to create job losses that he's proposing in his act would be to eliminate these costs and eliminate the investments that are necessary to promote economic growth. The measure of our economy is GDP, and what we're trying to do is increase our GDP, and that has increased over time, and we are going to do everything necessary to grow our economy, not slow it down, as this member is suggesting we should do.
New question, Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. Today, the OPP Commissioner testified about the serious charges they're investigating concerning the destruction of documents in the Premier's and other government offices. Can the Acting Premier tell us whether any staff or members of the Government Caucus are subjects of this investigation?
Minister of Finance.
To the House Leader, Mr. Speaker.
Government House Leader.
Mr. Speaker, I think we need to correct the record here. The OPP Commissioner appeared in front of the committee this morning and confirmed the following. He confirmed that there's ongoing work by the police force. He confirmed that
from Renfrew, Nipissing, Pembroke will come to order.
Those involved are cooperating fully. And he also confirmed, Mr. Speaker, that we should allow the police to do their work and to draw no conclusions. And, Mr. Speaker, I would advise all honourable members of the House that we should listen to his advice and, as is the tradition of this place, allow the police to do their work, to not speculate, and certainly to not interfere. And I would hope that the Leader of the Third Party would take that advice to heart.
Thank you.
Well, Speaker, the House Leader can downplay it as much as he wants, but this is a serious matter. This is a criminal investigation, which is another thing that was confirmed this morning at committee. There could be some heavy sentences that come as a result of these investigations. Now, given the seriousness of this matter and the government's stated commitment to transparency, will the Acting Premier commit today that anyone who is subject to this investigation be asked to step aside pending its results?
You know, Mr. Speaker, this line of questioning really is beneath the leader of the New Democratic Party. We have a situation where the police are undertaking work, and as is the tradition of this legislature, we should get out of the way, Mr. Speaker. We should allow them to undertake their work. We should not draw any conclusions. We should not speculate. Mr. Speaker, if the honourable member wants to talk about the gas plants, then perhaps her and the members of the opposition could talk about their position going into the last election and the fact that they had the exact same position as the government. Mr. Speaker, they're hoping that that fact gets forgotten, Mr. Speaker, but I'm sorry to say it's not going to be forgotten. All parties in this legislature opposed the two gas plants, and all parties would have taken the exact same action had they been in government.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, the House Leader's fancy footwork is a disservice to the public of this province. The police have an important job to do here, but the government actually has a responsibility to the public. When someone is under investigation, they have to step aside. I'm asking the acting premier to make that basic commitment today. Either confirm that no members of the government caucus are subject of this investigation, or tell us they'll be stepping aside if they are. Will the acting premier make that commitment?
Mr. Speaker, you know, just to repeat, and I believe the finance minister made the point clear that when the commissioner appeared in front of the committee this morning, one of the things that he stressed repeatedly was the full cooperation that he is receiving from the government. When inquiries are being made, there are no roadblocks or obstacles. I believe he used words to that effect when they're undertaking their work. And again, Mr. Speaker, I would advise the leader of the third party that she accept the traditions of this House, and they're there for a very good reason, Mr. Speaker. We allow our law enforcement agencies to do their work in an unencumbered way, and I also think that it's doing a disservice to this legislature to try to draw any conclusions, to try to speculate, Mr.
Thank
Speaker.
You.
Let's allow them to undertake their work.
Thank you. New question, leader of the
Thank
third party.
You, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Finance, but I think that the minister the Minister of Government Services and House Leader needs to remember that there's a tradition in this House to step aside when you're under criminal investigation. Yesterday, I asked the Premier, Speaker, whether the Liberals will keep the promises that they actually ran on in 2011, and she proudly threw the 2011 platform under the bus, saying she wasn't the Premier then and she's the Premier now. Can the minister list which promises from the 2011 platform the Liberal government will be keeping and which ones they're throwing under the bus?
Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, I appreciate the fact that the leader of the third party recognizes that we have a platform, they do not. And we are going to continue doing what's best in the interests of the people of Ontario. We're going to continue stimulating economic growth. We're going to continue investing in job creation measures like our youth programs. We're going to continue combating the excessive costs, as I believe both parties recognize is important around reducing auto insurance rates, for example. We're taking the steps necessary to maintain a very dynamic business climate
Order.
That attracts those investments into our province, Mr. Speaker. And we're going to invest in transit. I'm not certain where they stand on that component, but we need to invest in those modern infrastructure projects
Answer.
That are going to create a very competitive environment in our province and pay huge dividends in the future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Speaker.
Supplementary.
Speaker, maybe the Minister of Finance knows something that we all don't know if he's got a platform ready to go. People have been let down a lot of times over the last 10 years, this Liberal government, and they have a hard time trusting Liberal promises, Speaker, and it doesn't help when the Premier makes contradictory promises. The government starts throwing out parts of the platform that they were elected on. Now, can the minister explain to Ontarians whether the Liberals will keep their campaign promises from last time to hold the line on taxes, or whether they'll keep their new promise to raise taxes on families?
Mr. Finance.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm not certain where the member opposite is coming from now, because what we're saying is we're going to invest in those initiatives that's going to stimulate economic growth. We're investing $35 billion over the next 3 years to promote infrastructure so that we take care of the issues that created an uncompetitive environment over many years of rule by another party. We need to invest in those initiatives. And when we talk about maintaining a dynamic business climate, we are the party that actually cut taxes from 5.5% to 4.5% for small business. We introduce accelerated capital cost allowance to enable those businesses to be competitive.
Member from Stormont, Dundas,
we actually eliminated taxes for 90% of businesses in this province by eliminating the employer health tax. We're taking those steps, and we've created over 164% more jobs in this province than ever before. So we are being competitive, and the reason is we have a dynamic climate in Ontario.
Final supplementary.
Speaker, the last time that families had a say, they voted for a government promising not to make their lives more expensive with new taxes, tolls, and fees. The Premier likes to say that this is a new government, but anyone looking across the aisle today can see it's the same old Liberals. Does the minister really expect people to buy the idea that this isn't the McGuinty Liberal team, that the Premier wasn't the co-chair of the McGuinty Liberal campaign, and therefore doesn't have to abide by the promises everyone on that side of the House made during the last election campaign?
Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, we have introduced an increase to the minimum wage. The party opposite was silent throughout the entire process.
Yeah,
they make reference in their platform, but they didn't even discuss it during that time that we needed some deliberation. The third party has also not even discussed what is critical for the well-being of Ontarians in the future, and that's retirement security. No mention about this pension reform that we are so important for our future. We are taking those steps. We're taking leadership on those initiatives to protect the interests of Ontarians, both young and old, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question, the member from Chatham-Kent, Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment. Minister, this morning, Heinz announced that Hybrid Canco will be taking over a portion of their Leamington plant as a co-packer, saving many jobs in town. This announcement is great news for the people of the town and is a good start, but there's plenty of more work to be done in Leamington. I want to ensure that the province continues to make Leamington a priority. The town is still at a net loss of hundreds of jobs, and I will continue to work with Leamington Mayor John Patterson trying to bring new jobs to the community. Minister, what are your next steps to help those in Leamington whose jobs won't be saved?
Thank you. And I will remind the members on this side that I've been hearing a few people mentioning people's names, and it'll stop. Last warning. The Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm proud to say this morning that there is a great announcement coming out of Leamington. I'm not sure if the member opposite is supportive or not from his question, but we're bringing back literally hundreds of jobs to that important community, and I'm so proud of the announcement this morning by the Heinz Company and Highbury Canco that they're investing in that community. The facility will stay open. Heinz has signed a letter of intent with this company. It's good. Canadian company to bring hundreds of jobs back to that community and for them to continue as a contractor producing food and food products for the Heinz company. So this is great news for the Leamington company, Leamington area. I want to commend, quite frankly, the mayor, Mayor Patterson, the Economic Development Corporation of Windsor Essex, who've been working very hard on this. Certainly the member from Windsor West, Teresa Perusa, and all of the members in government, the officials that have been working so hard to make this work. This is a great day for Leamington.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Just for the record, these jobs were created by the private sector, not by this Liberal government. Chatham-Kent has lost over 10,000 jobs since this Liberal government took power in 2003. Height, McKesson, Worthington Cylinder are just a few of the latest to either shut their doors or reduce the size of their operations. But I'm going to tell you something, Minister. My riding knows how to turn this challenge into new opportunities. But this government is not doing enough to help. Employers should not have to pay high energy rates or struggle with red tape. The good news is the PC Party has a plan ready to kickstart our economy. Our government and the NDP are talking about creation. And you know what? You can help us. So, Minister, help us help you. Will you, do the right thing?
Thank you. Stop. You see it, please? You see it, please? Thank you. The Attorney General will come to order. Minister of Economic Development and Trade.
Get it? Why is he so angry?
I am shocked at this response, and I think the member opposite should just say thank you. And private sector jobs are exactly what this province needs. He should talk to Mayor Patterson and understand from him and others just the important role that this government played to make that private sector deal happen. In fact, we did our due diligence with the investor that has the agreement with Heinz right now. We introduced that company to Heinz and looked and worked with them on an almost daily basis to make sure that that opportunity, any other private sector opportunities, could come to fruition. We're so proud again that hundreds of jobs are coming back to Leamington. If the member opposite doesn't like that, I think he should move elsewhere.
I am prepared to say something, but I'm not going to do it until everyone's listening. I've said many times in this House, I don't like it when individuals are attacked. And I will not tolerate it. We're more honourable than that. New question. Member from Nickel Belt.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Premier.
But as questions continue to grow about CCAC, about healthcare dollars being diverted from frontline care to executive pay, we know that our home care system is falling short. Nurses, some of them here with us today, have spoken out. Patients have spoken out, and problems just continue to grow. Why, then, after years of promises, has the government yet again failed to fix our home care system?
Mr. Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I appreciate the question. I appreciate the concern that we need to do to continue transforming and delivering good health care in our province. And I congratulate the nurses who are here today who do a tremendous job on the front lines for our communities. We have taken a number of steps to promote greater health care in home care. We recognize that the work that CCACs are doing. We also recognize that we need to ensure that more attention and more support goes to the front lines so that we can deliver the health care where it's needed, when it's needed. And that's exactly what we're doing, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
New supplementary.
Speaker, the first step to fix a problem is to admit that you have one. The NDP is giving this government an opportunity to finally take steps to fix the problems in home care. I have given the clerk a motion for a legislative review of the community care access system, outlining a process that would allow us to immediately and publicly look at CCAC, look at their executive compensation, and identify what needs to change, what needs to be done so that home care can be fixed. My question is simple. Will the government support an immediate and public review of CCAC?
Thank you. Acting Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We have, and I know the Minister of Health commented on this yesterday, that we're more than open and welcome to further investigations. We have always taken that step to be more transparent in the work that is being done by CCACs and throughout the system. In fact, we're going to be introducing legislation in regards to capping executive salaries, recognizing the dichotomy that exists between the very high and those in the front line. So we're taking those steps as well. So I welcome the input. I do look forward to knowing what the third party has in store for this. We already know what the opposition want to do. They want to cut your jobs, and we're not going to do that. We do want to work. We want to continue to invest and provide support for health care and for the front line, so I welcome your suggestions in that regard. Thank you.
Thank you. New question, the member from York, West, Southwestern.
York Southwestern. Mr. Speaker, thank you. My question is for the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing. On December 22nd and through Christmas, municipalities across the Greater Toronto and Hamilton region were affected by an ice storm that caused great damage, leading to about 830,000 people and customers losing power. Our Premier, our government, our members were out working with affected municipalities, helping constituents all across the GTHA. Now, the fallen tree branches are being picked up, the warming centres have closed, the street salted and cleared. However, our municipal partners have expenses that they incurred from the storm. Mr. Speaker, through you to the Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing, could you please explain how our government plans to support the recovery from this event?
Thank you. Minister of Municipal Affairs and Housing.
I want to thank the member for this very important question. Since the ice storm, 32 municipalities have passed resolutions asking our government for assistance in helping to pay for the ice storm's cleanup. In January, I was able to meet with the GTA mayors and regional chairs in Mississauga and hear their concerns and have, a very constructive conversation. After evaluating their submissions, yesterday I announced that our government will provide up to $190 million to support affected municipalities through a one-time special ice storm disaster relief fund. As a former municipal councillor myself, I know how important and critical the role is of municipal government and the role that they play in disaster management. I want to thank them for their work. Our government knows that this storm had a significant impact on municipal budgets, and I'm proud that our government will provide critical relief, whether through this needed assistance or the approximately $3.2 billion that we provided in uploads last year.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I would like to thank the minister for the answer. I'm pleased that our government will continue to work with municipalities on ensuring they receive the support that they need to recover from the ice storm. Great. However, as our government has increased support for municipalities, the federal government continues to fail to give Ontarians its fair share of federal transfers, disadvantaging Ontario cities and towns, as well as every Ontario citizen. Ontario has been experiencing more severe weather, like the ice storm and the flooding that occurred in the GTHA region over the summer. Municipalities from across Ontario are looking to disaster mitigation to ensure that Ontarians' property and lives are protected. Mr. Speaker, through you to the minister, could the minister please explain to the House what action she has taken to ensure that the federal government works with our government and municipalities to ensure that we are able to cope with this extreme weather?
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. As climate change occurs, events like this summer's flooding or this winter's ice storm will occur more frequently. And these problems are not just ones that affect Toronto, the Muskokas, or Sault Ste. Marie. It's a nationwide issue. It's one that the federal government continues to ignore. That's why, following the ice storm, I wrote to my counterpart, the Honourable Stephen Blaney, Minister of Public Safety and Emergency Preparedness. Because these events occur, and municipalities rightly need to begin to look at how to mitigate their effects, whether it's through the redevelopment of stormwater management systems or making our hydro system more resilient. I appreciate the federal government's recent commitment to national disaster mitigation, but I fear it will not go far enough and Ontario will not receive its fair share. Ontario and the whole country needs essential investments to address the priorities of Canadians and municipalities. That's why I'm urging all parties in this House to stand with our government, pressure the federal government to come to the table and discuss how we can best mitigate the effects of these disasters.
Thank you. New question. The member from
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Transportation. The hardworking people in my riding of Thornhill pay their fair share of transit taxes and would like this Liberal government to do its fair share. Instead of giving families in Thornhill the transit that they need and want, this Liberal government continues to waste tax dollars on scandals and is moving forward with a $640 million east-west bus lane plan that doesn't properly address the needs of people in my community. Speaker, the hardworking people of Thornhill want to know if the Minister of Transportation will abandon his ill-thought-out transit plan and commit today to building the Yonge subway expansion.
Thank you. Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure.
Thank you. I want to welcome the member to her house and tell her, having not been around her that long myself and sitting up about where she is, I'm very honored to get your first question and very glad and welcome. It's also nice, Mr. Speaker, to know that she has better manners than some of her colleagues. The Yonge Street extension is in the Big Move plan. It is a $50 billion plan. We are about $17 billion into it. Mr. Speaker, 90% of that money has come from the province of Ontario. In her area, the York region, we did a partnership on development charges, so they've been extending it. You can see the commitment in our partnership with Vaughan in the City of Toronto in the subway
that
is now in its final stages of completion. So I'd be confident that I think our track record's there. I look forward to working with her to realize that project.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, again to the Minister of Transportation. Minister, for a decade under this Liberal government, residents of York Region have been asking for the expansion of the Yonge subway, not just talk about it. They need it to Richmond Hill to service Thornhill, Markham, Richmond Hill, Unionville, Aurora, and Newmarket. But instead of getting the infrastructure that the residents of Thornhill need, they continue to send their hard-earned tax dollars to this Liberal government, watching them spend it on everything from Orange, eHealth, and the gas plant scandals. Minister, why do you insist on reaching into taxpayers' pockets to pay for all of your waste and scandal?
You see it, please. You see it, please. Thank you. Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. I would actually invite the member, because I'll go on a tour with you, if you like, of the initiatives that we have. Mr. Speaker,
That'll do. The member from Renfrew, Nipissing, Pembroke, that's it.
There is $4 billion in GO service. The GO Viva partnership is connecting these subway lines and our GO Transit, so there'll be an east-west connective piece. It's a very successful project, highly integrated transit. We have accelerated and increased the number of GO stations, building parking lots and more, and providing bicycle facilities, Mr. Speaker, as well as the subway, this subway extension and others. There are a number of projects. The priorities are being set in partnership with the regional governments and the municipalities, so we think they're very reflective of that. I really would invite her to a tour. Love to spend some time with you and welcome again.
Question. The member from Niagara Falls.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Energy. Yesterday, the respected hydro watchdog, AIMCo, released its annual comparison of industrial hydro rates in North America. And once again, Ontario had by far the highest rates of industrial users of any comparable jurisdiction, $94 per megawatt hour compared to $56 per megawatt hour in New York State and a very low $32 in the U.S. industrial Midwest, which competes with Ontario for good-paying manufacturing jobs. Tens of thousands of jobs have been lost in the Niagara region and southwestern Ontario because of this government's high hydro rate policies. How does this government justify its job-killing hydro rate policy to the people of Niagara and southwest Ontario?
Thank you. Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, as we know, We've invested $31 billion in the sector in the last 10 years because the system had been left to deteriorate. That put pressure on prices, Mr. Speaker. We all know that. We therefore created a number of mitigation programs to help individual customers as well as industrial customers. And Mr. Speaker, the member may not be aware of the Industrial Electricity Incentive Program, which we started about 18 months ago, Mr. Speaker. This uses surplus power to give discounted power to our own industrial customers. And last month, we announced some of the people who had been successful in that program. Mr. Speaker, Detour Gold was one of the successful proponents in the first round and claimed at the program. They issued a press release, Mr. Speaker, claiming that the program will save them $20 million this year, Mr. Speaker.
Oh, my goodness. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, as if the present industrial hydro rates weren't bad enough, the government's own long-term energy plan calls for a 30% increase in industrial hydro price by 2018. This is going to result in a loss of thousands more good-paying jobs. How does this government justify a 30% increase in what are already by far the highest industrial hydro rates in North America?
Thank you, Minister of Energy.
We have a plan for the electricity system. The 20-year plan, Mr. Speaker, projects cost increases annually of 2.8%, which is better than most other provinces. Mr. Speaker, that party, the third party, has no policy on energy. They will not.
Member from Bruce Gray, Owen Sound will come to order.
They are against refurbishment. That represents over 50% of our generation. And here's their policy.
And Stormont, Dundas, and South Glengarry.
50% of our energy. How will it be produced? Nothing. Mr. Speaker, they stand up and criticize, and they close their eyes to the very significant mitigation programs we have to help our industries in Ontario.
The question, the member from Glengarry, Prescott Russell.
Well, thank you very much, Speaker. And my question is to the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment. Speaker, our priority as a government is our economic plan to invest in people, to invest in infrastructure, and create the right business climate for job creation. We've had great success so far. Employment across the province is up by 440,000 jobs from the recessionary low of June 2009. Just last year, employment rose by 95,000 jobs. Speaking with constituents and neighbours and friends across Glengarry, Prescott, Russell, they constantly agree with me that jobs in the economy is a priority for them and should be a priority for our government. Speaker, our government has made tremendous strides throughout the province through our regional economic development funds. Could the minister please provide an update to the House on the funds and how they're creating jobs across this province, including in Eastern Ontario and Prescott, Ryan?
Member, the Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the member from Glengarry, Prescott, Russell, for this question. Mr. Speaker, just this past October, we celebrated the one-year anniversary of the Southwestern Ontario Development Fund, a fund that was actually modeled after the Eastern Ontario Development Fund that's been around for nearly 5 years. And through these, we've committed as a government over $100 million to these two regions in regional economic development, but importantly, Mr. Speaker, leveraging a total private sector investment of $980 million, almost $1 billion. These investments are helping to create and retain so far over 24,000 jobs in Ontario communities, jobs that are a direct result of this government's initiative to help companies invest in
expand.
And of these jobs, Mr. Speaker, 95% of them are manufacturing jobs.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for sharing with this House the great work that our government is doing to help create jobs and grow the economy. Wow. Our province's success relies on working together with all sectors to spur growth and create good-paying jobs at home. Speaker, from my own experience in Glengarry, Prescott, Russell, I know that the Eastern Ontario Economic Development Fund has created and retained jobs in and around my riding. They have included new jobs in agri-food, aerospace, and construction sectors. Dart Aerospace in Hawkesbury, Holder Tractors in Embrun, Bo's Beer in Van Cleek Hill, Alexandria Molding in my hometown of Alexandria are just a few examples, Speaker. Speaker, through you, Could the minister inform the House of specific investments we're making in communities across the province to get the economy moving and providing employment for Ontarians?
Thank you. Minister?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, this government has created the conditions for companies to thrive here in Ontario. We have a competitive tax rate, a labour force that is one of the best qualified in the world. Recently, I attended an announcement of Original Foods in Dunville, Ontario, southwestern Ontario, expanding their operations to hire 150 people out of that important community. We also supported a company called Pillar 5 Pharma in Arnprior, and through our investment, our partnership with them, the company is adding 56 new jobs and retaining 94 more. And in the members' riding, we partnered with Dart Aerospace in Hawkesbury, creating new manufacturing jobs for local families. Mr. Speaker, unlike the official opposition who voted against and did not support in any way, shape, whatsoever these two important regional economic development funds, we believe that it is important to consider industry as important partners in supporting the growth of our economy, and we will be there to support them when they need that support.
Thank you. New question, the member from Newmarket, Aurora.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Community and Social Services. Speaker, my constituent, Shay Nakjaban, was placed on a wait list for residential care at the age of 14. She is now 34 years old, 20 years on a wait list. Shay suffers from multiple health conditions, including epilepsy and seizure disorder, Dravet syndrome, a severe brain disorder related to epilepsy, cognitive delay, autism, diabetes, and obesity. Speaker, she has behavioral problems that often result in seizures and self-inflicted injury. Her aging parents have done what they can over the last 20 years to look after her. They now have their own health issues. For years, specialists have recommended 24/7 residential care. I trust the minister will agree that 20 years on a wait list is not only unconscionable, it is immoral. I'm asking the minister today, will you intervene on behalf of Shay and her parents and ensure that her care is looked after through resources in your ministry?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Thank you. The Minister of Community and Social Services.
Thank the honourable member opposite for his question. He's a champion of people with developmental challenges and the families that support them, and he was kind enough to bring this particular situation to my attention. He knows I can't comment directly on the case. It would be against the law to do that, but I can say here that we're aware that some individuals have very complex needs that make it very challenging to find a placement. It's the responsibility of the Developmental Services of Ontario and community agencies to work together as best they can with families to explore possible solutions. It's my job to make sure that that's done as effectively as possible, and I believe on the whole it is. That said, and I need to note that, of course, it's helpful that the extra $42.5 million we invested this year is bringing more developmental services to the fore.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, I did bring this matter to the minister's attention, and I can't tell you how disappointed I am in the response. What I was hoping to hear from the minister was that, given the fact that his own ministry has agreed to put this woman on a priority list and she has been there for years, that he would ensure that his own ministry's priority would be honored. Here is what's happening. Shay is being put on a priority list. Residential providers are skipping her in favor of other patients who don't require the same complexity of care.
Wow.
I call that discrimination. What should be happening is that his ministry should be honoring their own recognition of Shay's condition. I'm asking the minister one more time, rather than giving me platitudes and generalities, will he commit to work with me to ensure that Shay and her family are looked after?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Thank you. Without the extra comments, please. Minister.
Thanks, Speaker. I'm pleased to continue working with the member opposite. I appreciate his advocacy, truly. In fact, I appreciate the advocacy of all the folks in this House who worked together to support, as I did, the creation of the Developmental Services Special Committee. That's important work. In the meantime, let me make it clear, we need to focus, I think, on four objectives: expanding direct funding, supporting people better in key life situations, responding to people who have urgent support needs, I agree with the member opposite, and broader options for residential supports. We know, for example, that improving housing options is critical, and that's why we created, upon the advice of our partnership table, an interministerial housing task force to recommend a broader set of options. So we look forward to working together with all members of the House, and I await with breathless.
Thank you. Time's up. New question, the member from London West.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. Earlier this week, a media expose forced the government to finally fund the 9 empty beds at St. Joseph Healthcare's newly built forensic hospital. These beds were desperately needed to treat mentally ill offenders who are found not criminally responsible in the place where they should be treated, a healthcare setting instead of a jail. Today, Londoners are learning more about the impact of the funding cuts to St. Joseph's Healthcare that were announced this week. Just as they funded the empty forensic beds, will the Acting Premier commit to Londoners that his government will address the new problems that are sure to arise as St. Joseph's Healthcare deals with the loss of funding?
Thank you. Acting Premier.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Thank you for the question as well. I'm proud that our government has provided the necessary support to build the state-of-the-art Southwest Centre for Forensic Mental Health Care, which is now being completed in June of 2013. And it's important that we continue to provide the services for the individuals that are affected. And I recognize, especially those with developmental services needs and with mental health issues, that we need to find the proper support systems for them. So we'll continue to do that. But since 2003-2004, the number of forensic mental health beds has increased by 42%, Mr. Speaker, from 556 to 789, and we're doing what's necessary, and we'll continue to take those recommendations under consideration, as we must, for the benefit of the people of Ontario and those that are affected.
Thank you. Supplementary, the member from London Fanshawe.
Back to the Acting Premier. Last week, we learned that healthcare CEO in London received a 144% pay increase. Today, we learned that St. Joseph Healthcare Centre in London will be cutting 23 positions, including 8 nurses in the sexual assault, surgical recovery, and acquired brain injury program, among others. We know that cuts to nursing care directly impact the health of patients. A study released yesterday provided clear proof that increasing RN workloads resulted in higher death rates for patients. It was further reported, Acting Premier, that Ontario has the second lowest registered nurse to person ratio.
Shame.
Will
Shame.
The Acting
Question.
Premier tell us whether his government will intervene this time around, or will cuts to patient care be allowed to continue?
Thank you, Acting Premier.
So, Mr. Speaker, we have made a number of investments to transform the way we deliver health care. We are the party and the government that has increased the number of nurses in this province. We've added more than 20,500 nurses in Ontario since taking office, and that's more than 4,000 new nurses in 2013. In addition to the number of nurses that are now working full-time, it has increased by 50%. We recognize how important it is to have frontline health care. We know what it is that's necessary, and the member opposite cites probably a transformation of nurses from one site to another. The net result is more nurses in our province. We know how valuable the work you do and what you do for us, and we will continue to invest in that. And we know that we need to make those transformations for the benefit of health care, and we've got to find better ways of delivering that health care in a more fiscally responsible manner. It's not enough just to do across-the-board cuts that would sacrifice the needs of the community and the jobs that it carries.
Thank you. New question. The member from Ajax Pickering.
Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities. Speaker,
It is good news that Ontario is up 440,000 net new jobs since the recession began. However, there are still people out of work, even though the unemployment rate is moving steadily downward. But I remain concerned for our youth. The youth employment rate continues to be double the overall rate. Young constituents in Ajax Pickering, as recent as last night, have told me how challenging it can be to land that first job and to get real work experience. Whether they are out of high school or the post-secondary level, young people need the opportunities. We must engage employers in this solution as
Question.
Well. Can the minister advise this House what this government is doing to help young people get that job experience opportunity? Thank you.
Minister of Trade, College, Universities.
Thank you. Mr. Speaker, I want to thank the member for the question. I also want to thank him for his many, many years of service and as a champion of youth in the Pickering Ajax community. We all know he's done a lot of work in that area. Ensuring our young people have opportunities in our economy is a top priority for our government. One of our key initiatives is to create job opportunities for youth, and we're doing that through our Youth Employment Fund. The program offers young people an opportunity to gain some real work experience, learn work skills, while earning an income. The Youth Employment Fund was set up to help 25,000 young people over the next 2 years. Mr. Speaker, I'm very pleased to announce that in less than 6 months, as of Friday, this fund has already created 7,934 job experiences for young people right across this province. Something we're very, very proud of. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Speaker, thank you. It's really good to hear the Youth Employment Fund has helped so many young men and women find employment. And it's great that the minister mentioned this fund is also helping youth facing greater barriers to employment. Mr. Speaker, it sounds to me like this program has been very successful, and I can see where it may be working in big cities like Toronto, but I'd like to know how successful it has been in the rest of the province. Youth in rural and mid-sized urban communities face some of the greatest barriers to employment, and I want to know what we're doing, whatever we can, as a government to help them too, especially ensuring the success of this program is going to reach them. Mr. Speaker, can the minister please advise me and others on the
thank
success
you.
Of this program outside the large urban areas
thank
of Toronto?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Youth Employment Fund is serving youth right across this province. Since September, we've created 1,899 job experiences in the West, 1,278 in the East, and 969 jobs in the north, Mr. Speaker. This means this program is reaching out right across the province of Ontario. Last month, I traveled across the province talking to youth and thanking our frontline service providers and local businesses for making this program the success that it is. Speaker, I had an opportunity to meet a young man in Oshawa with a great name. His name was Brad, who, after years of unsteady work, secured a job at Durham Pallet Services through the Youth Employment Fund. This is what he had to say, Mr. Speaker. Quote, I love my job and I love learning new things. The Youth Employment Fund follows Durham Pallet to invest in me and cross-train me in other areas of business and allows me to learn at my own pace. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. New question. A member from the Northumberland, Quincy West.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Transportation. Minister, 2 weeks ago, I wrote you a letter regarding the lack of road maintenance service in my riding of Northumberland, Quinney West. Sadly, yet not surprisingly, I have not had a response. Stretches of the 401 in my riding have been unplowed for over 24 hours in some cases, which is three times longer than it is supposed to in order to clear a Class 1 highway, Minister. Minister, your government has cut the number of plows on the road in my riding from 17 down to 9 and the number of salt and sand stations from 4 to 2. For after 2 years, my colleagues and I have shown you areas where you and your government can save money without cutting services. You decide to cut funding the road maintenance, and now my constituents are paying the price.
Question.
Minister, when will you be increasing the resources for road maintenance services in my riding, and will you commit to not cutting these services next year?
Good question. Good question.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Minister of Transportation and Infrastructure.
Thanks,
I got to get the plows going.
Mr. Speaker, I listened very carefully yesterday to the honourable member's comments about the accidents on the 401, of which he and I share a great concern about. The difference is I actually waited until the OPP report came out before I commented. He was saying that it was bad plowing that caused the problem. The OPP report said the roads were perfectly fine and that it was a fog condition. Now, maybe the members opposite can control acts of God, but so that road was in good condition. Mr. Speaker, the member opposite may want to look at his own party's platform, because the reason that there are changes in the assignment of trucks and vehicles is because we as a government no longer decide how many vehicles are. The contracts that they put in place when they laid off 3,000 people in the Ministry of Transportation allowed the contractors to decide to do that, so he could talk to the contractor. We will be changing some of those contracts so this problem no longer exists.
Thank you.
But you also signed 12-year
Thank you. Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, Minister, the 401 in my riding is not being kept safe. This needs to change before someone loses their life due to your reckless cuts to service.
That's right.
Just yesterday, as you alluded to, the subpar road conditions were responsible for yet another wreck along the 401 just east of Coburg. This one forced the highway to remain closed for most of the day, costing millions of dollars to productivity to this economy. This is all because you wanted to save $800,000 in cutting services.
Oh.
Only in the world of liberal economics would this be considered a good business deal.
Liberal economics.
Your government has wasted billions on e-health, gas plant scandals, expense accounts to Pan Am executives, and a cushy severance payout to Chris Mazda, and now you decide to try and save money by reducing the scope of services that protect the lives of millions of Ontario drivers. Minister, when will your priorities return to ensuring the people of this province?
Thank you. Minister. Stand, please. Thank you, Minister.
So, Mr. Speaker, the member opposite is a member of a very respected profession. He's a teacher. And last time I looked, they taught civics and history, and they teach kids how to read and do research. So I assume before, Mr. Speaker, he decided to become a member for the party opposite, he would have actually looked at what their record are. Because prior to him presenting himself as a candidate, your party in government had laid off 3,000 staff of the MTO. Those staff were the people who actually did the plowing in your area. You decided as a government to introduce performance-based contracts, Mr. Speaker, and the reason that allowed contractors to use as much equipment and as many staff as they do. So if you would like to change that, as I would, I hope you'll support the reforms I will be bringing forward to restore the system before you lay 3,000 people off.
Thank you. New question. Member from Hamilton Mountain.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Education. Speaker, we learned tragic news this morning. Another child, a baby boy, has died in an unlicensed daycare. We know almost nothing about him, except that he should be alive today. Instead, his parents are devastated, and parents right across this province have another reason to worry about their children's safety. Speaker, one death is too many. Four deaths in less than a year is a crisis for families in this province. The minister's bill will do nothing to ensure that we have enough inspectors to keep kids safe, and her ministry will still be in the dark about unlicensed daycares that are operating. She's also increased the size of groups and staff ratios, meaning younger kids will have received less care.
That's dangerous.
Speaker, did her ministry know about this location, and how many families will have to be failed before this government gets it right?
Minister of Education.
Yes, thank you, Speaker, and my heart does go out to the family who are absolutely devastated by the loss of their little four-month-old boy. In this particular case, Speaker, my ministry was informed on February the 18th that there had been a death at a home on the preceding Friday, the 14th of February. When my staff investigated, they discovered that this was, in fact, an unlicensed home child care. My staff have in fact done a preliminary review of the records, and in fact there were no complaints about this particular facility ever, so there is no reason that the inspectors would have gone there, because in fact there have never been any prior complaints. It is my understanding that the police continue to investigate, as they do all deaths of young children, as are my officials. Thank you.
Thank you. The Minister of Northern Development and Mines on
a point of order. Point of order, Mr. Speaker. I just wanted to remind all the members of the House that the Prospectors and Developers Association conference begins this coming Sunday. 25,000 delegates from all around the world coming to look at the great investment climate in the province of Ontario, and there is an Ontario government reception you've all been invited to this coming Sunday, 5:30 at the Steam Whistle. We'd love to have you there, and the opening, of course, of the Ontario Pavilion on Monday afternoon at 1 o'clock, so we welcome you all there. Thank you, Speaker.
For votes, this House stands recess until 1 p.m. this afternoon.